वी आर लाइव नाउ। श्रुति शुड आई बिगिन?
सर लेट्स जस्ट वेट फॉर 2 to 3 minutes सो दैट निधि पुट्स द लिंक ऑन द टेलीग्राम एंड द पार्टिसिपेंट्स कैन देन यू नो ओपन द लॉग इन टू द यूट्यूब चैनल।
ओके
सो जस्ट फॉर दैट।
He has just given me the link. I'm just sharing it in.
Okay.
We can start now.
Yeah, the link is on Telegram. We can start now. We can start now also.
You can start?
Yes, okay. Yes.
Thanks. Thank you, Dr. Shruti. To welcome, a very warm welcome to all the participants of this two-week refresher course on re-energizing research, interdisciplinary and transcultural approaches to Indian literature. We have come to the midpoint of this two-week refresher course. We have done 7 days, and now we look forward to the next 7 days. But from the feedback that I have seen, we have received very encouraging and very good feedback from all of you, which makes us feel very happy, and we hope that the next 7 days also. We will be able to provide you with some of the best scholarship that we have with us, who will be speaking to you. The whole idea of these refresher courses is actually to bring the best scholarship, the best experts in the field, and that they speak to you, that they share their ideas with you, and which gives us an opportunity to update our own knowledge base and perhaps spur us to do a certain kind of research work in the fields that we are interested. So in continuing that same effort, we have today Professor C.A. Sharma, whom you've already met, those of you who were with us on the inaugural day, where he not only was there in the inauguration, but he also presented a paper right after the inauguration. So I don't really have to introduce him to you all over again, but there could be participants who were not there that day. So it would be my privilege, and I feel very happy to introduce one of the best teachers in the University of Delhi that we have. That is Professor Chandrasekhar Sharma, who is presently a professor in the very prestigious Sri Ram College of Commerce of the University of Delhi. Today, Professor Sharma is going to speak on interdisciplinary research aspects in Indian literature and management. So Professor Sharma's basic area is management, commerce, finance, and organizational behavior. That's these are his specializations, and he has over the years done research. He has authored 11 books, done 47 research papers, innumerable research students whom he has guided, a tremendous track record, and he is seen as a kind of role model by many teachers and many students whom he has taught. He's very close to Ramanujan College, He's a great supporter for many of our endeavors, and we are always very honored and very happy to have him with us. He is also, you know, I will fail in my duty if I do not tell you that he has been the director of the Maharaja Agrasen Institute of Management Studies and the JRE Group of Institutions. He is presently heading in SRCC, his own college, the national level refresher course programs, which are run under ARPIT, which is the National Resource Center that he runs in SRCC. And of course, he is, and who else can be, but he, the internal quality assurance cell director of his college. So I will not go into very deep, you know, into, I will not even dare to transverse that kind of topic that he has, which is to do with interdisciplinary research in literature and management. We got a glimpse of what he has been thinking about these issues in the inaugural day, where he tried to bring in our mythology and our legends, and tried to the Bhagavad Gita as a text, and tried to relate it to his area of specialization, which is management, commerce, and finance. So I, along with all of you, are very eagerly looking forward to what he has to say to us today on this rather very interesting topic, which is to do with kind of interdisciplinary way of looking at literature and management. Professor Sharma.
Good afternoon, everyone. Dr. Samanta, namaskar.
Namaskar. Namaskar. Namaskar.
Saha, Megha Sharma, Dr. Lata, and Ms. Nidhi, and all the participants. Thank you very much, Dr. Samanta, for saying all these nice words about me. It is always a great pleasure to be associated with the programs of Ramanujan College. I know this is one college in the whole country which has really justified the award of Teaching Learning Center by the Ministry of Education to you, to your college, because in the last 1 year's time, ever since the pandemic started, you have trained more than 150,000 teachers. And I think this is the only college or only teaching learning center which is truly active in terms of justifying the resources that have been allocated to it by the Ministry of Education, and also the confidence that has been reposed by the ministry in your institution. So I think kudos to you, kudos to your team, kudos to your institution, and all the teachers that you are doing such a great service to academics during this pandemic period, and utilizing this time for the purposes of upgrading us all and are enhancing learning of us teachers in a substantial way. Unfortunately, in this discourse, it is mostly one way. I wish it could be two-way communication, but I shall see what we can do in this regard. We shall have some question-answer session also later on. Today, the topic that has been given to me is interdisciplinary research in Indian literature and management. Well, dear friends, you know, over the last decade or so, maybe a little more than a decade, I have been trying to impress upon the audiences, as well as the teachers and researchers in both management and commerce area, as well as in the literature area, that we should take up research, interdisciplinary research. Those of you who were present on the inaugural day in the keynote address given by Professor Dorai Raj, he distinguished between the interdisciplinary research, multidisciplinary research, and the transdisciplinary research. So I would like to reiterate or repeat that for the benefit of the audiences and then connect it to my discussion. Interdisciplinary research is that you integrate the two subjects completely. That is the merge. That is, the subjects do not retain their basic identity. and they merge themselves completely, and absolutely a new thing emerges. That is one. Multidisciplinary research is that we take up ideas from the two disciplines, but both the disciplines maintain their identities, separate identity. This is from literature and this is from, say management. And transdisciplinary is somewhere in between the two, that you are neither integrating nor you are fully merged. Rather, there is some degree of melting of the two in the pots where both are trying to merge with each other. Now, as far as interdisciplinary research in literature and management is concerned, the first and foremost area that I have used very successfully, and we are trying to come out with some research papers in this regard, and that is relating to the pedagogy of management. I have used this in training, used literature for training the executives, working executives at all levels, from lowest level to the highest level of the CEO also. And what I have done in this regard and what we need to do in this regard. First, let us understand what management is about. In this regard, I would like to say very simply, in 1984, I was only about 4 years into this profession, and I had undertaken a short research project. And that research project was, what makes the business managers successful? Actually, the title of the paper was, what do the successful managers really do? Simple question. And we don't need commerce background or management background to understand my research. I would like to share it with you. And from there came the ideas. Of course, the ideas really hit me about 15 years back only, say after 2 years of this research. The thing was that what we did in this research, that we took permission from, say, about 84, 85 executives, practicing managers, that we shall like to observe you while you are working for a period of about 30 minutes at any time chosen by us. I mean, randomly, this is a mathematical requirement that the sample has to be random and the selection of event point should be random. So it was a very simple thing that there were large number of people who refused us, but there were large number of people who agreed also. Now, without going into why we were refused and why we were granted permission, but the system was that we would, I as a researcher was allowed to enter their meeting room or anytime I would choose for a period of 30 minutes, I would sit there. And I had prepared, with the help of the literature, 80 activities, a set of 80 activities that a person can perform while discharging one's duties. These activities included activities relating to decision making, motivating people, communicating, which included even cutting jokes. That is, there were subparts also. All right. Analyzing data, collecting information, gathering data. So what I would do, these were long 80 list of items. What I would do, or my assistants who would go to other places, what they would do, that we would sit around while the manager is still discharging the duties. Say he is talking on phone. So picks up the phone. This is an activity undoubtedly. So we would take communication. Then how he is talking. Is it formal, informal? Within formal, is it sharing information? Or he's cutting a joke? It is informal or what? Is he gathering information? Like this, it was a tedious job for us because each and every, even gestures, the expressions of the person, that is communication, which is paraverbal communication, because paraverbal communication is just as important as the spoken word or written word. If he is writing something, we would insist that you please tell us what you are writing so that we can at least classify. And many managers were really very generous that they shared with us some confidential information also. We did not use the confidential information, we assured them. We just told them that we will classify this information into a category. Is it written communication? Where is it decision making? Or it is seeking information, delivering information, gathering fact, interpretation, analysis, or whatever. Like this, we collected data from a large number of managers. And then we simply made the frequency distribution, like we make in class 8. We are taught, we are exposed to frequency distribution for the first time in class 8 when the statistics paper is introduced to us. Simple, which activity, how many times? That's all. There were 80 activities under 5-6 categories. And we just numbered how many these managers, how many times this particular activity was performed in the whole time. And then we classified it. Of course, we used some mathematical tools, advanced statistical tools called factor analysis and so on. But that is a different thing. We arrived at the same decisions, same conclusions through frequency distribution also, which we tried to arrive through an advanced tool called factor analysis. You see, basically factor analysis we had utilized because we wanted to look intellectual. It was actually contribution to the knowledge was on the basis of the interpretation of the frequency distribution that we had made. Now see, entire management, entire commerce is nothing but what I would say, common sense tabulated. This is the phrase I used. There is no discipline like management, no discipline like commerce. It's a very dangerous sentence for me to say, because I am attacking my own bread and butter when I say that it is not a discipline. But I am fully convinced that commerce and management are nothing but common sense tabulated. That's it. That's what it is. Now, I'll tell you, there were about a few activities, categories of activities. The category of activities were as follows. Number one, communication. Number two, decision making. Number three, gathering data and analyzing data. Number four, motivating people. Number five, organizing tasks. Organizing. Number six, creating a sociometric. Let me use a simple word, creating a network of relationships among the people. That's all. Now, of these, one activity emerged as the single most important. One of these. Now, can you write in your chat box or comment box, which activity do you think would be the most important in your opinion? Dr. Samantha, is it possible for me to gather the information?
Yes, it is. It is.
Let me repeat the category of activity.
Yes, we will be able. They can. The participants can write either in the YouTube thing link or in the chat box in the YouTube link.
I'm giving the categories again: communication, decision making, motivating, data collection and data analysis, creating a sociometry, that is network, and organizing the tasks. Communication also included the feedback. That is telling people, you are not doing right, you're doing it this way, that way. Even that included communication. In these, decision-making, very important point. So I'm repeating, communication, decision-making, motivating, organizing people, and of course, creating a sociometry, the networks amongst the people. These are the tasks that the managers did at different levels. Now, I want you to guess, which one is the single most important activity within this?
The participants so far have said communication. Most of them are saying communication, sir.
All of them? How many?
Not all. There has been one or two who have said motivation. One has said motivation. Two have said decision making.
Okay.
But communication seems to be the most popular, sir, as of now. Yeah.
Okay. I want more. Ask them to.
Well, yes, sir. Again, communication, network relationships, network of relationships, decision making and communication.
Okay.
Communication, sociometrics.
Okay. So communication is emerging as the most.
Yeah, communication is emerging as the most popular one, sir. Okay. We have, yeah.
I think I can ask my audience now to stop and listen.
Yeah.
Actually, my finding was the same as what majority of you are saying. Communication. Talking, communicating. And within communication also, there were formal communication and informal communication. What surprised me or us researchers at that time was that it was the informal communication which the managers indulged in more than the formal communication. This was surprising finding for us. And then, you know, there were some activities in this range of activities that dealt with in informal communication with emotions. Management of the emotions of the self and managing the emotions of others. This was the second most important activity that emerged as most successful. And that was the year 1983. We are repeating the same exercise now again as a part of a PhD thesis currently. And some preliminary results have come from a sample of about 50 persons, 52 persons. And results are statistically the same. That is, to be successful. And how we define success, let me explain that also, since researchers are listening to me, scholars are listening to me. In my methodology, we defined success in a very different way. We developed a coefficient. The age divided by your position within the hierarchy. So if your age is low and your position is high, say you have fifth position in the organization, high in the hierarchy above, and your age is only 20. So 20 divided by 5 will come to 4. But suppose your age is 60 and you are at 5, so your score will come to 12. So success is the lower the score on this, the more successful you are. And we simply ran correlations, et cetera, those things were there. Those are different things altogether. But simple common sense, simple exercise that it came communicating, informal communication. And managing the emotions of self and managing the emotions of others. And surprisingly, when we saw the amount of time devoted to these two activities, it worked out to 64% of the total time spent by the managers on this in our sample. And around the same time, it is coming in the latest study that is going on. We've got a small sample data of 50. There it has come this percentage has increased to about 72%. Now people are spending more time in communicating and more time in managing the emotions. Now, why did I talk about this particular thing? I talked about this particular thing that when we discuss in management or commerce, we talk about teaching or preparing the managers for the future. Our task is that we prepare successful managers. And if we have to make somebody successful, then research tells us prepare that person for communication, prepare that person for managing emotions. Now the point is, my dear friends, can communication be learned? Number one, can emotion management be learned, or it is a part of the personality? I am sure when you people means the literature people, when you are either creating something or you are analyzing something or you are analyzing the characters, the critical evaluations that I have seen, I find that you make a comment. about the character. The character is calm. You pass judgments. You read a character and the critique passes a judgment on the character. I'm not saying it is wrong. It is okay. The person is calm. But from whatever, when I make the phenomenological study of the description of the characters by the scholars of English literature or any literature for that matter, what I notice is that you describe the character as if the personality of the character is a given factor. It is given. It is ingrained. The character is like that. It is. It may have different dimensions of the personality, but you describe it. Now, this is one thing. Very good. Very important point. In real life, this, if I take this description to the real life characters, then I would say there is an assumption by the authors and critics in the literature that personality has already been cast in stone. That is, it is an outcome of one's genetics, as psychologists would say, and the conditioning of the individual. There is no scope for change. And interestingly, whatever few, I mean, I'm not, my word is not final. My knowledge is very limited. My conclusions, therefore, are not broad generalizations. I would make a simple statement that the characters are not shown to be transforming. Characters are shown to be evolving. Characters are shown to be expressing themselves in different ways, but not transforming. The thread of the character, the basic core of the character, remains the same throughout the writing. That is there. Okay. Now the point is, this is not the purpose also of literature. But I would like to use this particular thing for developing good managers. If I have to develop, or if we have to develop good managers, then I think the best teachers would not be the people who have been trained in commerce or management. I think the best people will be the people from literature. Why? Because we have to train the future managers or even existing managers in good communication, number one, and we have to teach them good amount of, I mean, how to manage the emotions of self and manage the emotions of others. For example, a lot of research has been done in two fields. One is called what we call the emotional quotient, EQ. There are different type of intelligence quotients which psychologists have developed. One is called intelligence quotient, and there are many. Music quotient is there, and then travel quotient is there. But another one is very important, which we call the emotion quotient, emotional intelligence. And similarly, we have now grown over to the social how to manage this. Now, one thing is that I have done a lot of training. I have trained managers in this particular aspect, and I conduct my classes also for the purposes of helping people develop their emotional intelligence and social intelligence. Now, first most important thing in this regard is that the person is able to given an opportunity to connect with oneself. Now, psychologically, we all human beings have been endowed with one feature, which psychologists call rationality. What is this? Or we call it rationalization, not rationality. I will call it rationalization. And what is rationalization? Rationalization is justifying your own behavior. Each of us, each human being, has this of rationalization. Each one of us does everything what we think is correct in any given situation. And we have a reason for it, even for murdering somebody, even for abusing somebody, even for acting cheap towards somebody, looking down upon somebody, hating somebody, disliking somebody, of course, liking also, and expressing compassion, love, care, even for our prejudiced behavior, we have justification. This feature has been given to us human beings by nature, and that is rationalization. And this creates a great defense inside us. What that defense is, that we think what we think is right, we think what we do is right, we think what we feel is right, that is thinking, feeling, and doing. Action, thought, and feeling. All these three things are considered justified by us human beings. And these are the other persons who are in the interactional situation, whether it is a dyad or it is a triad or it is more than three persons, five persons, six persons, whatever, it is others who decide whether that is right or wrong. Within our own self, we all feel justified and correct. But in prospecting and then facing the unsettlement of what you have done, unsettling what you have done, and then taking the right course of action and changing yourself. That is what the process of making a good manager is. How to do this? That is a very big challenge for us teachers, for us trainers in the field of management. Now, how can this be done? I am coming back now. I feel that people trained in literature can do it in a much better way. How? Because when we try to make the person introspect, you ask somebody, how do you feel about looking down upon an inefficient colleague of yours? The person may not express that idea. What prejudices do you have? If I asked you this question, you will never answer this, because this question has social response bias. By social response bias, I mean that your response will not be what you genuinely think. Your response will be what you think that the other person will like to hear. So you will give a reply, not on the basis of what your true thinking is, but you will give a reply on the basis of what can please the other person who is interacting with you. So people do not come out with their feelings. People do not come out with their true value system. They do not express their regrets. They do not express their, what we will say, disappointments. People do not even express their expectations. People don't express their inner feelings or reactions and the conclusions about the people. They don't. So how to do that? It's a very, very big challenge for us. We can do this when we teach them the very thing with the help of stories. People very easily identify themselves with the characters. And I have successfully used this particular thing to a very great extent. And since I'm an ordinary teacher of an ordinary college of a fairly well-known university called University of Delhi, my words do not carry much weightage. Though idea may be good, but when I say that similar thing is being done at Harvard University, that they are training there the managers with the help of stories, then this idea would definitely carry weightage with the people. And the reason is, again, very simple. Very simple reason. We human beings are like that. A lot of research has been done on this aspect of human behavior, that human beings are driven by perceptions rather than logic. And there is a person called Daniel Kahneman for propagating this particular idea and conducting a lot of human experiments on this very idea. This fellow was awarded with Nobel Prize in the year 2002. And you can read a book of his if you like, Thinking Fast and Slow. Also, there is another author, Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman. Also, there is another author by Daniel Ariely. I'm forgetting the title of the book. As I recall it, I will let you know. But the author is Daniel Ariely. Something Irrational. That is the title of the book. Again, so we human beings are driven by perception. And I have a proof to talk about that. You see, if you'd ask anybody in University of Delhi today, which college is working most? Which college is contributing most to different stakeholders, students, teachers, and karmcharis, and everybody? The answer will come, it is Ramanujan College. I'm not saying it because I'm using their platform to address you. It's a fact. Every day there is something new coming out in this particular college. But when India today had to give the ranking, it gave them a ranking below colleges which are known for not doing anything. And what is that? Basis is what? Perception. Perception plays a very important role. Let me come back to, after this hyperlink, let me come back. In Harvard University, they have started employing this particular method of using literature to teach the managers. Now here comes a question. Which stories should be utilized for the purposes of training the managers? This is a question of research. This is a very important point of research now, and who will do it? Obviously, people like me who are trained in the discipline of commerce and management, or even psychology for that matter. We are not trained for this. The identification of the emotions and ease of identification of the reader with that emotion of the character, this can be best done by the people from the field of literature. What are those dominant emotions which can be, whose management can be taught appropriately by the faculty of management discipline for preparing future managers who are very strong in respect of A, management, in respect of communication, and in the management of emotions, managing their emotional intelligence and managing their social intelligence. Now, the research here is this, that you can do, the literature people, and can enrich the discipline of management and commerce apart from enriching their own discipline. It is this. For example, in emotional intelligence, there are certain aspects. Those aspects include, for example, setting up the goals, looking at the self-motivation, for example. In social intelligence, similarly, there are some aspects. What aspects? Such as the management of narcissism. Each one of us has that element of narcissism. Now, how to capture it? And it is very difficult. How to manage narcissism of your boss, who thinks he's always right? Finished. How to communicate with that person? Or a person who is bloated, narcissism is bloated sense of self-importance. You have a colleague who has bloated sense of self-importance. Okay, that person needs appreciation. I mean, he has insatiable appetite for appreciation. I mean, how much appreciation, however much appreciation you may give to that person, that will remain completely unsatisfied, because the narcissist always has this feeling that the whole universe revolves around him or her. Like we say, the earth rotates around its axis. So narcissist feels that, a very important aspect of social intelligence. And we all have this element in each one of us. Now, if I want to teach this, can you please tell me, I mean, I would ask my friends in literature to give me a reason, give me the story or a novel, and give me the reason why, and you connect it with the literature of the psychologists who are dealing with it. Second, another aspect of social intelligence is deception. There are two types of deceptions. I've done some research in the field of what I call facades. You know, we all have some degree of self-deception of which we are often not aware. That is one. And second is that we create deception for others. We do not present our real self. For example, it is very simple, very simple. You know, we out of courtesy, we say hello to even those people who we hate most. The person you dislike, man mein vichar aata hai, in the mind, the thought is, oh my God, while you are entering the college, for example, one day, and you come across an individual who you don't like, but you bear a smile on your face and say hello to the person, and inside you are thinking at that time, today's day is going to be very bad. Look who I have come across while entering the college right in the morning. This is a deception. And when you are dealing with subordinates, when you are dealing with the bosses, we create deception. It's a topic of philosophy, undoubtedly. But how to be conscious of the deception you are creating, and how to decipher the deception being created by others. If we can train that, we will create people with superior social intelligence and superior emotional intelligence. This requires research. Can you connect the features of the events described in the literary text or the characters which are there or the entire narrative that is there? Can you identify that structure which relates to deception and connect that structure with the existing literature on deception, literature created by philosophers, because this topic belongs to philosophy, and the psychologists? This is second. Third area, which is very important, and that important area is both very important for emotional intelligence as well as social intelligence, and that is vulnerability. We all are vulnerable. And I think those of us who are teachers, even today, for example, when I am coming and addresses, I have some degree of vulnerability in me. I am addressing on a topic which is unconventional. I am addressing to an audience which does not belong to my field at all. I am addressing the people. I am talking of something very, very new, very different. Will it be accepted? Not accepted? That fear is there in my mind when I am talking. That vulnerability is there. A lot of work has been done in vulnerability. How to manage this vulnerability? Because in business, another very important thing is for success, that is innovation and creativity. Innovation and creativity, so that your relevance stays. World is changing. You have to survive in business, you have to innovate, change, and adapt to the changing tastes and demands of the people. And if you don't do that, you will not survive. And here, one thing more, one very important thing, my dear friends, it is, I would like to make this statement very clearly, very, very, very categorically. And this is on the basis of my interaction with my friends who are in the field of literature, whether English, Hindi, Tamil, or other languages. I have found one thing very common with all these friends of mine. My sample is small, but I think many people will agree with what I'm saying, that these people of mine always look down upon business and business people. They feel that the reality of business, I mean, make you lower humans. This is what the feeling is. I'm sure everybody would not be sharing this opinion, but my sample of my friends is, they are so ensconced into their own thought processes that they do not even look at their salary slips for which they have joined their organizations. And when we talk about our salaries with them and the calculation of DATA and other things, then these people frown. What is this? You think there are better things in life to discuss. But here I would like to say one thing, my dear friends, that we must have respect for commerce and business. And it is required, because from the moment we are born till we die, commerce is an essential, integral part of our life. And look at all around you. Accept this mind, which is inside your head. Everything else is as a result of commerce. The air conditioner, the technology, the laptop or the mobile phone, it has come to you not because of the scientist. Scientists developed these things, the fan over there, the furniture that you are sitting on. Designers have made them. The designs on your shirts, the design of the spectacles, everything, the oil that has gone into on your hair and everything else, the cup which you are using for the purposes of drinking tea or coffee. All this has been developed by designers, the scientists, the creative people. But these things would have remained confined to the confines of laboratories or the board of the designers. If the business people had not brought it to the market, we must have respect for them. And mind you, one more thing, that whatever tax that is collected by the government, a huge, huge portion of that, rather 80% more than that of that, comes from the business class, the trade. So if we respect this particular thing, this particular aspect, and if that respect is there, then of course, this class of people who are doing business, they need to be developed with the right kind of orientation. And that orientation would include communication, emotion management, and third very important thing, the values. Value of what kind? Ethical values. And how to teach that once again? By making the people introspect in some way. For example, I'll give you one example. I was conducting one particular program somewhere in one business organization. And there, the chief executive said that we have a problem here relating to caste, categories of people. Some people, there is a grouping in which on along caste lines, and this is a big problem I am facing in this particular organization. It's a private organization, undoubtedly, we have people belonging to different categories. All are very intelligent. I do not want to lose any of them. But because of this fact in the undercurrents, my productivity of my organization is being affected adversely. Can you do something about it? I did a simple exercise. That exercise, that was a program for 3 days on attitude. What I did was that I used a small story of about 3 paragraphs. And I will tell you the gist of that particular story in 3 words, 3-4 sentences. The story was this, that there was a place, a barn. In that barn, there were a large number of sheep. And there were some other animals also. All the sheep were white. Once, the mother sheep gave birth to a sheep, a cub, which was a lamb, which was black in color. It was different. And because it was different, therefore everybody avoided him, taunted him, did not play with him. And this black sheep, the tribulations, trials and travails and troubles faced by this particular lamb was discussed in the story. And as he grows up, then what happens? How he eventually becomes the leadership and how he gets accepted completely by everyone. This was the story we discussed. There was no mention of the caste here, but differences, egregious differences was the main core of that story and how to manage it. And this, interestingly, when this started at 10 a.m. on the first day, the whole day we kept on discussing this. We divided up people in the groups and they started discussing this and different emotions that came up, different ideas that came up. The next day, my complete program of 3 days was devoted to only this single story. End of the day, the program wound up, and after 3 months' time, I took the feedback again. What were the changes? And we had some counseling sessions also who opted for discussing this later on. And amazing it was. It was amazing. The owner, that is the chief executive of the company, also told us that there is a substantial, massive difference that has come about. After 6 months' time, they said once again to me that please conduct another program with them to reinforce the values that they developed in the previous program. And we were in a fix. I was in a fix. My fix was how to get a story now with which the people can identify at this time. Who would help me? Who can help me? Now, obviously, I have to look forward to assistance coming from the people from literature and who have done research in this particular area. Managing different range of emotions in different situations. Now, this is the pedagogical contribution that can be made by you people in developing workplaces which will be healthier. Now, when I make this statement, developing workplaces which are healthier, it's a massive statement. All of us, we all survive. We all survive through economic activity, mind you. We human race. This human race survives through economic activity by producing, whether we produce a service or we produce a good, we survive on that basis, our survival. And the workplaces, whether they are family business workplaces, whether it is a farm or it is a business enterprise, or it is a shop, it is a manufacturing unit, or it is a service unit, or it is a call center, or it is a team which is building software, wherever, whatever, you can contribute towards the creation of healthy workspaces. What contribution can be made? And when we talk of this, the literature can create a discipline, which discipline of pedagogy of or teaching of management of social intelligence and emotional intelligence by all the disciplines. Because people from each discipline eventually go to a workplace, whether as an entrepreneur or their family business or as an employee. This is one area of the social utility of literary studies that has been completely ignored so far. And it deserves attention by you. This is one area, my dear friends, that I think that where management and literature can come together substantially. Number two, one broad area I have said, I have talked about emotions, pedagogy, and so on. Another area where literature research, interdisciplinary research or multidisciplinary research can be carried out, and that leads to we will say the direction in which the society is moving. We call it social psychology. Mirror, literature is the mirror of the society. How, and one thing more, very, very important. It not only describes what is true of today, it also talks about what will happen in future. Way back in the year 1933, I'm talking about. You can imagine the kind of society we had at that time. There was a storyteller in Hindi language called Premchand. He has written a story, Balak, which has been translated as Immaculate Child by one of the former professors of Ramanujan College, Professor Ghai. The title of the book, if I say, it is God's Share in the Stale Rice and Other Stories by Professor T.C. Ghai. The 17th story in that book has been Balak, has been translated as The Immaculate Child. Now, if you read that story of that time, this is the story about a man and a lady. The lady who has had several husbands. A lady who was thrown out of an ashram also. This gentleman gets married to her. Everybody looks down upon him. Why is he getting married to such a lady? And that lady eventually leaves him also. And when he contacts her, he finds out that she had delivered a baby just after 6 months of his marriage. To deliver the baby, she had vanished. The baby is somebody else's child, not the person who had married her out of love. But this man willingly accepts the child. The story is something like this. The story written in 1933. It's a complete contrast to the kind of value system that society had at that time and even today. it's a story worth reading. I do not have time that I could discuss that story with you, but I have discussed this story again and again in my training programs for the purposes of the need for love to take precedence over so many other things. Love to take precedence, love towards your consort, or love towards your love, not influenced by what society will think. It is unimaginable kind of a thing. And the kind of discussions we've had in this regard, they're amazing. This is what is required. This is second dimension of the literary studies, which is needed for creating a system of ethics where humanity and your deepest emotion of love takes priority or takes precedence over everything else in the world. Third, very important thing. And last, the direction in which literature can move and it can contribute to the society. And that is this. In 1953, United Nations had come up with a development document, policy prescription for us. This is the Western model. Because we know, we see that Indian society or the societies at large, whether it is India or it is China or the ancient societies I'm talking about, these societies have been subjugated by the Western world. At least in the last 250 years, we have remained subjugated by them completely. And it is their model which is dominating us very substantially. And I'm quoting from, not exactly quoting, but I'm speaking from a document developed by United Nations. And what it said that these societies must reject, if they have to develop, their ancient philosophies and practices. A new value system needs to be developed so that the modernity, now who defines the modernity? So that the modernity becomes the dominant value in these societies. Now, everything has been moving in the very same direction in one way or the other. Now, this is a very important thing. Now, for example, now a few things I would like to share here. Now we, very simple thing, ancient, this is ingrained as part of the culture. We go to the restaurant. And if I am saying wrong, you please make a comment and Dr. Samantha will tell me about it. We go to a restaurant, four or five of us, whether we are a part of family members or we are friends. Say we are family members, let's first start from there. We are family members, we go to the restaurant and we are four members, we select four different dishes. 99% it happens like that. And everybody shares everything. Am I right if I make this a statement? Does it happen most of the time? Dr. Samantha, can you tell me? Does it happen like this or not?
Probably it does, I think.
Mostly. I'm not saying 100%, but 90% of the times. Dr. Shruti? I hope,
yes, sir.
I'm not saying anything unusual. As an Indian, this is the normal behavior.
Yes, sir.
Okay. If husband and wife go to the restaurant, they don't share the bill. I pay for myself and you pay for yourself. We do not do that. We Indians don't do that. Hum sochte hain ki jo, whatever is of my wife, is mine, and whatever is of the husband, that belongs to wife also. We don't consider them as two separate identities. We consider them as one whole. Once again, there may be exceptions to this rule in India also, but this is what it is even today. Even today. But go to Germany. There, same family members, each one orders one dish separately for each of them. And they don't share. Husband and wife, they pay for the food separately. Only two things I'm saying. Third thing, another thing. Again, think of 90% people, 95%, 98% of Indians as a whole. When we go to the swimming pools, or we go to the saunas, or we go to the spas, do we become collectively nude? Do men and become nude at the same place for the spa or the sauna? Unthinkable. In Germany, it happens. Individual happiness, the individuality of the individual is more important in this modern model of modernity. We here are more collective. And way back in the year 1853, great Karl Marx, while writing in New York Times Herald Tribune, he writes about India. He writes a very interesting thing about India. He said, one thing unique about India is that this country is surviving. India is a nation, first thing. He recognized, the Karl Marx. India, he recognized as not a state. He describes India as a nation. 1853, the Karl Marx. And he writes, very interestingly, he writes, India is a nation. And the core of his economy is village. And the continuity of producers and consumers is the characteristic feature, that continuity of the relationship between the producer and consumer is so strong, and that creates a bond so that the exploitation is the least. There is least exploitation. No, he uses the word little exploitation. There is little exploitation. This is what Karl Marx wrote about India, describing India. This is the dimension. So two things now here. Literature represents, mirrors the society. It directs the society by not only showing us the mirror, but also it projects and creates, and it tells us where it should be. It describes not only is, but it describes should. And here, the onslaught that has come on India under the garb of modernity. And what is that? You demolish the ancient philosophy. The demolish the very foundation on which the country rests. So far they have succeeded a little way, but still they have not been able to succeed. Imagine the look at the value system of the people in West. I've given you two examples only, two or three examples I've given to you from everyday behavior. They have not succeeded so far. But as individualism grows, you know, individual becomes more important than others. The child has his own life. That is the statement. Not the parent. And what has happened, my dear friends from literature, I have studied all the textbooks from class nursery to class 1 to class 12. From there, except in Sanskrit books, a few sentences have vanished, which used to be there when I was a student. Like what? If you are in trouble, look to your parents. Like Mata Pita Ishwar ki tarah hai. Place of them, parents, is like that of God. You worship parents, you get everything. These sentences were there. They have vanished. Parents have been replaced by friends. In class 6, we give them Jain Iyer. We give them Wuthering Heights. The story of love between husband and wife. Right away. Whatever it is. But it has happened. Now, again, as I would say, this is one direction on which there needs to be there is a need for reflection by the researchers, scholars, and students of literature. Because I know that it is this literature which will give direction to the society. And it will build, rebuild, or kill the fabric, social, emotional, individual, sociometry, as well as psychometry of the human beings. So these are some of the thoughts that I wanted to share under the topic interdisciplinary research in Indian literature and management. If there are any questions, my dear friends, I would be too willing to take them up.
So there were not questions, but some comments had come earlier on. We don't have too much time, but I just read them out. Vomkeshwari Kesi Shri, he writes, Panchatantra stories are used to teach Fayol's principles of management.
Yes.
This is one. He also said that... he also kind of commented that Freud's theory can be used to handle the problems of narcissism. That's what he said. The other interesting comment that came from Anil Ahir is that literature is set on emotions and values, whereas management gives priority to practicability. That's what he's said, which I think you have kind of addressed.
You know, you know, what is practical? What is practical? I'll give you an example of practicality. Practicality is this. A company in Finland was facing losses. And they had to reduce costs. Okay? Practical question is very simple. Most important cost or biggest cost is human cost in any business organization. Because when you employ the person, not only you pay the salary, but also there is a cost of printer. There is also a cost of laptop. There is cost of electricity. The moment the person enters, air conditioner has to switch on, electricity cost is there. Larger the number of people, that these are called incidental costs of managing the workforce. So whenever there is cost cutting, the word for this is in management literature, or the management shop floor language for this is restructuring. Throw the people out. This is very simple, easiest. It is done. I mean, everybody does it. Like pandemic came, restaurants closed. What everybody did? Ask the people to leave right away. And when pandemic opened, I mean, when the markets opened, they got the cooks and one or two waiters purely on the basis of what you can contribute. If you have no work, you go out. Now I'm talking of this company in Finland. And I'll give you two examples here. Company number one. They had to do the restructuring, and suddenly a buzzer was pressed one day, and the buzzer was announcing the fire in the building. An announcement was made over the public address system that everybody should leave the organization, should leave the building immediately. Do not carry anything with you. Please leave. A few managers, a few persons who were standing on different floors, because everybody had to go out through the staircase and not through the lift. There were people standing on each floor who were collecting whatever the people were carrying in their own hands. Laptops were not allowed to be carried. Please go out fast, leave it with us. And people were moved out. They moved out. It's a real story I'm telling you, real incident I'm telling you. And once everybody was out of the institution, out of the building, an announcement was made again on public address system to the people that the people can walk in, condition has been created. The identity cards which are not responding need not enter. Need not enter. Some 80% people were in, 20% people were out, and they were told, come and collect your checks tomorrow. And after 2 weeks, they could come and collect their material. It's a real story. This is how the restructuring was done in this particular organization. Story number two. Similar situation. Similar thing happened. Company was incurring losses and they had to reduce the costs because orders were not there. The top management called a meeting of all the people and they said to them, they simply said to them one thing, that we have pressures for reducing the costs. There are two options. Either certain number of people, they gave the number, have to go from different echelons of the organizational hierarchy, or let everybody decide to work for 5 weeks for 4 weeks salary. Every fifth week that you come in, you will not be paid. And these weeks can be traded by you among each other. That is, somebody cannot afford to lose salary for one day, 1 week, then that week can be donated to him by somebody else. Or collectively you can do it. And can you beat it? Everybody accepted the idea. And can you beat it? Within 6 months' time, there were huge cost savings everywhere by the same workforce. And instead of 1 year, within 6 months' time or 7 months' time, the company had recovered its losses and moved into profits and salaries were restored. Now, this is what the value system is, and this is what the practicality is. Values and practice cannot be placed in mutually exclusive cabins. Values and practices go hand in hand. How you behave with your student will depend on your values. Very simple. That is it. So these are the issues. It is the sensitivity, human sensitivity. It is this kind of sensitivity that needs to be built up. And let me tell you, my dear friends, these thoughts inspire. There was a time when in business schools, we taught that consumer is the boss. Consumer first. And now we have moved to, from there, employee first. Consumer will automatically be satisfied if your employee is satisfied. You take care of the employee. Employee will take care of the consumer. Employee will take care of the profit. Undoubtedly, profit is very important. Business means, by definition, when we use the word business, by definition, it means a continued economic activity for making profit. Cost has to be less than the revenue, undoubtedly. But cost can be less than the revenue when you do not treat people, human beings, as machines. It is possible. So when you say, dear friend, whoever raised this question, management is practical, literature is not, I think literature is more practical. You have been wrongly told that you are not practical. You are very practical. Very practical. Only thing is, you close your eyes to the practicality. To make yourself different. To make yourself look different. That's all. That's all. That is the only difference, nothing else. You are better equipped to teach management, provided you do research in that direction. Or you guide us, develop a new discipline. How you can develop this kind of value system among the people, how you can create that sensitivity. That is it. And if you cannot do this, that means you are negating an old age adage that pen is mightier than, please fill in the blanks, pen is mightier than sword. Please, I think I have responded appropriately to the best of my.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Thank you very much, sir. That's been very nice. We don't have too much of time, but I must, before I formally thank you, I want to say that today happens to be Baishe Shravan in Bengali, which means 22nd day of the month of Shravan, which also happens to be the death anniversary of Rabindranath Tagore. And the interesting thing is that Tagore's father, Devendranath, who's called Maharishi Devendranath, he of course belonged to a very rich family, which was a family wealth made by Dwarkanath. But Devendranath was not a very good person in terms of handling money or those kind of things. So the family lost a lot of money. But when Rabindranath grew up as a poet, he was sent to the ancient, the place of his estate, which was now it is in Bangladesh, Shilaidaho. And everybody knew that Rabindranath was a good person with money and with accounts, and he would get the family back, the family wealth back. Now, this is an interesting thing which comes across, that he's probably one of the greatest poets that India and the world has produced. But he also had a sense of how to run his estate. It is not as if, so literature does not always mean that we are in some world of fantasy and make-believe. And finally, sir, I also wanted you and my participants to know, and my friend Ratna, who has come here, would also agree with me, about a decade back, Delhi University had introduced a paper for BCom honors students in the first year. This paper was called English for the Students of Commerce.
Yes.
And we had a very interesting book, which had a set of poems and short stories and essays. But interestingly, whoever had compiled that book had compiled all these things with the idea that money is not everything in life. So all the poems and all the essays and all the short stories had this basic idea that money was not. So I really enjoyed teaching that paper to BCom honors students, and we would have very interesting conversations about what money meant in life. And it was a good interdisciplinary kind of interaction we used to have. Unfortunately, Delhi University has removed that course. And now we only teach letter writing and communication skills to the commerce students. Yeah, Ratna, you want to say something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say, Nirmalya, that, you know, you left the main dilemma which caused the university to withdraw this text, because English for the Students of Commerce, that was the name of that book, was really compiled by the English teachers who felt that they had inputs to give to Students of Commerce. You know, we even taught them The Great Gatsby at one point in time.
Yes.
But the commerce department suddenly flexed its muscles and said that, you know, we can manage the English and we don't need the English department. And they introduced us courses called business communication.
Yeah.
So all literature, all ideas went out of the window, you know. And now, I mean, so this was a huge problem. So today we are teaching students letter writing. We are poor business skills.
Yes.
In Venkateshwara College, we had to actually hand wrestle with the commerce department. Ab, you know, public forum mein main ye keh rahi hun, we had to hand wrestle with the commerce department and say, nahi ji, angrezi hum padhayenge. Commerce department said to us, hamari to tumhe koi sawari koi zarurat nahi hai. The mother department is supporting us and they feel that we are completely competent to manage our English. So, you know, it was really brinkmanship. For some time, Dr. Sharma.
You know, actually, these are the things relating to what we call power games or whatever you call it. Or dusra ye hai, commerce or English literature. Everybody should understand one thing. Ek badi clear si baat hai. Agar hum ethics or values ki baat kar rahe hain, to ek badi simple si baat kahi jati hai ki we should earn through 1,000 hands.
Okay.
Because as I said, without economics, we cannot survive. Without commerce, we cannot survive. Prosperity is required. Economic prosperity is required. We cannot afford to look down upon creation and accumulation of wealth.
Absolutely. I agree with you. My friend Nirmalya is a fabulous photographer.
With heart.
And without commerce and money, he could have never bought himself the equipment,
We don't have to become a Shylock.
Yes.
That we take the heart out. No. But we earn through 1,000 hands.
Okay.
That is definitely there. And this is, again, I'm quoting from Upanishads. But it has to be done together. Sahana vavtu, sahana ubhunaktu, saha viryam karvavahai.
Tejasvina amadhitam astu.
Yes. Ma vidvishavahai. There should be no envy.
Yes.
The ma vidvishavahai is there should be no envy. So very important factor, emotion is there. And I think when it got down, turned down and everything that happened, it all happened because of that envy. Maybe that there was a feeling perhaps that English is taking over commerce.
Possible.
It happens, but I still feel my feeling is very strong, and I have utilized literature in a very fruitful manner, not only for myself. We as teachers do not do teaching for ourselves. We always do teaching for others. This is what the beauty of our profession is. And the greatest beauty of our profession is that we enjoy the success of others. Our student does well. He reaches higher echelons. He earns more money. He gains fame. And we take joy in saying he's my student or she's my student.
Quite true.
It's the only profession which has this kind of blessing. But this thing which is reserved for our student should be there for the colleagues also. So this generosity, open-mindedness, and open-heartedness needs to be there. So this is, that is what, Sahana Bhavatu, together we are nourished. Sahana Ubhunaktu, today together we grow. Sahaviryam Karvavahai, together we are able to gain glory. So this is what is needed, what is required.
Thank you, Professor Sharma. Thank you for this very interesting, provocative presentation. There are lots of things to learn. Things keep changing. What it was in the 80s, are no more like that. Things have changed in departments, in the way pedagogy works nowadays in institutions, the use of technology and so on and so forth. So many of the things that you were saying in terms of how commerce and management as disciplines need to interact with English literature or social sciences are very valid points. And I think we all, all the participants of this refresher course, who are teachers or who are going into the teaching profession, will think and mull over these ideas that you have.
और मैं एक बात कह दूँ यहाँ पर आपको, एक चीज और कह दूँ.
हाँ हाँ.
There are journals for management education which are A-rated. और इन journals में, in these journals, papers are getting published very easily. Simple okay. thing. On pedagogy, we sent a paper recently. It's an A-grade journal. And we simply talked about this connection. I mean, particular emotions or ethical behaviors we said, and how it can be taught, that we listed out. And some experiments we had conducted that we gave. Some data we collected from the control group and the experimental group. Made a little bit of analysis, which was qualitative essentially, not mathematical. And it got published. So if you, for your academic career also, this is a very good area.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. So these are new areas of where English literature students or social science students can come into and work. Professor Sharma, thank you very much for giving us your time and for this very interesting lecture. We have a second session today. And that is with Dr. Ratna Raman. And interestingly, she will be speaking on myth, text, and cinematic representation, the shaping of the modern female subject. So it's a kind of cultural and literary, more in our domain, so to say. It is a great privilege and a great moment for me to welcome Dr. Ratna Raman. Dr. Ratna Raman has always been Ratna for me because way back in the early 80s, we both started our teaching career together in Hindu College, if I'm not mistaken. Absolutely. And we were young people at that time. We are still very young. I can see Ratna. And Ratna's, I'll talk about her lecture, the abstract that she's given us, but she's presently the Associate Professor of English in Venkateshwara College of University of Delhi. And her work is to do with culture studies and literature, cinema, and of course, gender studies. She's very well known in the university for in all these areas. She has been publishing on education, health, and women rights regularly in newspapers and journals. She has been significant contemporary issues, contributing significantly in the hard news. She writes a blog, which is In the Midst of Life. She's also a writer. She has published short stories and articles on food and culture. So it's a wide range of interests that Dr. Ratna Raman has. And today she will be, I think, looking at the intersection of gender studies at one level, because her topic concerns the modern female subject. And she will be looking at myths, texts, and their representation in a rather modern medium, which is the cinema. I mean, modern in the sense that of all the other mediums that we have, cinema is just about 110 years old. So she will be looking at this. So if I could just briefly read out the abstract that she had given us. This session analyzes myth and female subject from the point of view of two texts. The first is Silapathikaram, which is a text that we teach in Delhi University from ancient India. And the second is Padmavat from medieval India. which of course is a well-known text now after the film. Dr. Raman looks at the cultural construction of female entities in these narratives and further discusses the representation of these entities in contemporary times. For the cinematic representation of Silapathi Karam, she analyzes the Tamil serial titled Kannamma Bharati, and for Padmavat, she studies the Bollywood film with the same title. The speaker uses the text and the context to show the manner in which these palimpsest sets are being created for the modern Indian woman through different patriarchal conditions, or I can say the different patriarchal lenses. So Ratna, we are very, very happy to have you at Ramanujan College. The programs that we do are taken across the nation to people who are very far away from us, and we are connecting to them, reaching out to them with some of the best academics like you, and sharing with them thoughts which you are engaged with in your research and your work. So, Dr. Ratna Raman.
Thank you, Nirmalya, for that glowing tribute. And I'm perfectly happy to be addressed as Ratna, because, it's just this, if we start saying Dr. Nirmalya and Dr. Ratna and Dr. Who, just sounds like we're in the middle of some medical emergency, which is definitely there in the liberal arts, but it becomes a freer space otherwise. Okay, so since you have already read out my abstract, I'm just going to start by saying that I'm looking at the shaping of the modern female subject, and I'm interested in looking at myth and the significant role it plays within cultures, because all cultures have ancient stories that enable us to understand how cultures have represented themselves, and again, how cultures represent men and women through their myths. And these myths are stories that are handed down generations. They become important meeting points and conduits that allow us to trace the framing of female identities over millennia. And my interest in this area comes from my own identification or my own space as a modern female subject who came of age in independent India and grew up in a post-colonial space in which notions of the self and a gendered identity were shaped, formed, and punctuated by a whole category of, by categories or aspects of language, class, caste, economic, and social forces. Of course, when one looks back to take stock of the most impactful forces, it is the world of oral narratives, those of storytelling, and then literature, in the form of abridged, translated, and original texts, slowly and closely followed by the world of cinema and television that arguably remain the most significant of influences. And the other thing that we must always remember is that we do most of our things as a society with secondary occupations through speech, through thought and through speech. So action is only a later correlant for all those of us who are within inverted commas, mind workers. So to look again at what is the role that stories play, what is the role that literature plays, if we were to go back and look for answers in the Republic written in the 4th century BCE, we would find that Plato, who's written this book and who models his narratives on the basis of the dialogue, which interestingly is the most fabulous way of connecting and making communications, Plato actually says that for the making of an ideal republic, and why is he making an ideal republic? He's saying this is a place where societal justice must be situated. So he says we need to eliminate a lot of things from the ideal republic. And then when he's asked what, he draws attention, among many other things, to the power of the emotive word. So in the ideal world of the Republic, the poet or the writer, the playwright, these narrator of epics, they are seen as exerting a great influence upon the imagination of the listener or the viewer through their powerful emotive language. So Plato's argument is that utterances by poets can prove to be dangerous because the poet, through his powerful words and narratives, can color impressionable minds by portraying the vile and immoral behavior of the gods and humans. And I mean, if we look back, look at how many times Indra, for instance, the king of the gods, embarrasses us, and thereby sanctioning such depravity instead of raising the mind to higher truths. So Plato himself comes from a powerful space in Athens, watches the Peloponnesian War, and comes to the conclusion that poets who color the truth have no place in the ideal republic. So he sees poetry as immoral, he sees literature as immoral, and based on falsehood, therefore capable of corrupting minds through what is actually a perversion of reality. Of course, it is left to his disciple or student Aristotle to argue for the importance of the truth uttered by the poet, to draw attention to the cathartic nature of poetry and literature, and to explain that mimesis is not just imitation, but a representation of reality as visualized by the poet or the playwright. So it is Aristotle who makes out a case for the functioning of the poet. And the functioning of the poet, the significance of the poet's worldview, the significance of literature, and argues for the need of imagined stories that can inspire, influence, and guide real lives. So while Aristotle's defense rescues the poet, it is only fair to suggest that very often rules formulated, and you know, when I say rules formulated, within inverted commas, we are talking about management, rules formulated on the basis of the thinking of an individual or a group generate their own control and authority. So sometimes a book of codes can be laid out outlining such vision. And history is a very important witness to the fact that ideals set out either by religion or a community or an individual or an oligarchy continue to shape our social and personal lives in ways that need to be examined and analyzed. And this, I would suggest to you, is really the primary purpose of a literature, because it allows you to analyze, it allows you to think, it allows you to make connections, and it allows you to interpret for yourself. You know, in a parallel universe in ancient India, there is this very gifted man, Bharata, Bharata Muni, he's referred to. And there are these apocryphal stories of how he was summoned by the gods and said that, you know, give us entertainment. And he invented the drama. But he wrote this book called the Natyashastra, of which we have evidence, between the first century BCE and the third century CE. And Bharata's Natyashastra not only argues for the relevance of the aesthetic sentiment, but sets up a palette of rasas, which are to provide both instruction and edification for all manner of citizens, as well as elaborate instructions on the setting up of a stage, the body language of the stage, and the various sanction gestures and actions that can be undertaken on stage, to say nothing of the musical instruments and other stage accompaniments. Bharata is also very clear about what cannot be represented on the stage, what cannot be done in the realm of the drama. So the Natyashastra is a handbook of rules that have been carefully formulated, again by a philosophic poet, exploring the impact of language, music, dance, and drama on the audience. So interestingly, so I'm just suggesting to you that there are literatures, there is material of various kinds or various categories, there are handbooks, and there is creative fiction. And to this world of sound, storytelling, theater, and text, as modern inhabitants of a global universe, we need to add the realm of cinema and television as formative influences. In fact, the author I worked on for my PhD, Doris Lessing, says at the beginning of the previous century that film is really the medium of the 20th century in the way that the novel was of a previous century. So when we look at cinema and television as formative influences, because so much of our time is spent now watching what used to be once called the idiot box, we need to retain our role as interpreters and analysts, as dissenters or critics, because it is in the realm of connotative language that we continue to voice and frame the ideals that have so many shortcomings when implemented in the real world. So to go back to my own story and why I am talking about these two texts, as a young person, as a young Tamil person who was raised in New Delhi, several sets of narratives were available to me. Of course, English continued to grow from strength to strength as a medium of influence, of leisure, and of work. And Sanskrit faded into a ritual backdrop despite compulsory and optional lessons, both at school and at college. So it was predominantly Tamil and Hindi traditions that I grew up with and drew upon. Adding to both languages was a formidable set of grandmothers, aunts, and mother whose lived experience outlined for me the Lakshman Rekhas that I had to take cognizance of. Upper caste Tamil women from shy white households lived tough lives, juggling household work and expenditure while raising sons and daughters, pretty much in the manner of women of similar means in communities and towns and villages all over India. So while I grew up in New Delhi under the watchful eyes of my mother and a benevolent patriarchy at home, there were long summer months when we escaped the brutal heat of New Delhi's summers to shelter in Chennai or Madras, as it was then called. In the sultry summers of the south, punctuated by cool sea breezes that made early mornings and late evenings completely habitable. I mean, this is the only problem with Delhi in the summers before the rains. Within the home, both in New Delhi and in Chennai, our leisure time was spent listening to stories that my grandmother and mother would narrate or read out in Tamil, familiarizing us with several stories of heroic men and women who peopled the southern lands. So apart from Nachiketa, I learned about Shivagami, I learned about Savitri, I learned about Gayatri, I learned about Kannagi, I learned about Akka Mahadevi, and I learned about Andal. Our textbooks at school in Delhi were no different. I learned about Sati, Parvati, Mirabai, Panna Devi, Pannabai, Rani Padmini, Chittoragarh, Rani Lakshmibai, and a galaxy of other figures, both male and female. Access to television was non-existent. We gathered to watch black and white Chitrahar at our family physician's home once a week for half an hour and got to see two films a year at the cinema as an occasional biannual treat. It is as an adult teaching literature at Delhi University that I began to read English translations of both sets of narratives to arrive at the conclusion that the Indian woman was really a very complex product. She led a life always that of a second-class citizen, never mind the fact that she could be a princess or a queen. And the audiovisual medium of television and film had also grown exponentially by this time. And it provided us points of entry into discourses set up around epic stories and modern narratives. So how did television and cinema feed into our cultural consolidation? I would argue that there was a reiteration of certain notions of women, good mothers, faithful wives, disciplined daughters, outside of which remained the evil woman, the other woman, the vamp, the scheming manipulator, the anti-heroine who was to be recognized and shunned. There were also the codes of beauty and color, wealth and poverty, talent and the lack of it, and of course, the monitoring of the good woman's sexuality, while simultaneously, cinema and film used visual aids to draw attention and tantalize the viewer with body parts of women and move the narrative to usually unnecessary exposure of flesh. And they did this trying to circumvent the moral censure boards. Simultaneously, frustrating young women in their experimentations with their clothes and bodies and their lives. The rules in cinema were also fairly clear-cut by now. Premarital sex was out. The hero could celebrate the female body, ranging from Kajrare Nayan to Anchals in which Halchals existed. But other than a glimpse of the midriff and a bare arm, the good heroine displayed coy virtue usually, telling the prurient camera, which when it asked choli ke piche kya hai, that the choli housed her dil, not her breasts. So cinema managed to create a new woman of feeling and emotion who proudly wore her heart under her choli. And cinema gave us fair and voluptuous women filled with sentiment through which they proved their devotion to their husbands, families, cruel in-laws, were selfless mothers battling against the state. That was a welfare state only on paper. So if the beautiful Shakuntala, capable of bearing a male heir, was the icon that captured the European mind as an understanding of Indian womanhood in the 19th century, nationalism and independence conjured up for us a chaste older woman, Ma, who embodied the motherland, Bharat Ma, whose commitment to the state and family and the domestic world was unparalleled. This telegenic capture of female identity remains most compelling. Coupled with the older mythic roles that poets allotted to women, the stage continued to be rearranged for the shaping and sculpting of the 21st century female subject in an exciting new avatar, one that breathed color and sound and movement into the older mythologies. For instance, just look at how the role model of the emotive mother in our private lives is offered up for consumption to all of us as we grow up. You know, you have this very belligerent Amitabh Bachchan who's having a showdown with his brother and he's telling him, aaj mere paas building hai, property hai, bank balance hai, bangla hai. And this always used to puzzle me because bangla also meant Bengali, but here he's talking about the bungalow. Bangla hai, gaadi hai, kya hai? Kya hai tumhare paas? And at this, he receives this very quiet answer from Shashi Kapoor, who says, mere paas ma hai, because the mother is not living with the wealthier son. So the audience stands up and claps and catcalls in cinema halls all over the country. So once again, the emotional sustenance provided by the mother reiterates the ethical superiority of the son who had chosen to live by the values the hardworking mother had espoused. In our daily lives where mothers lived in houses and had access to transport, women's work is apotheosized, usually with reference to cooking. So there is the unparalleled taste of Maa ke haath ki bani garam roti, if she was Hindi speaking, or the kai manam, and this is a very Tamil expression. It's actually kai means hand and manam means fragrance. So the attention is being drawn to the fragrance of the hands that, you know, provide these delicious flavors into cooked food and create such delicious food. Meanwhile, what is it that were offered to our long-suffering mothers or hardworking mothers in the difficult domestic spaces that were available to them? They were inspired by the Sita story in their years of growing up as an antidote to their personal suffering, which was in turn offered to us as young girls when we quarreled or complained or were belligerent. Look at Sita, one grandmother would opine. She was the daughter of a great king and married to Rama, an avatar of Vishnu himself. She went in the forest with Rama uncomplainingly. She was so beautiful that Ravana abducted her and wanted her to be his wife. Yet as a Pativrata wife, she could not think of anyone other than Rama. Her monogamous conjugal commitment reunited her with Rama, the Agni Pariksha notwithstanding. Agni Parikshas were good event, grandmother felt, because Sita's purity was established. However, shortly after they went back to Ayodhya, a washerman thrashed his wife, because wife beating is sanctioned culturally everywhere, suspecting her of infidelity and said he could not be an accepting husband like Rama. This apparently convinced the blameless king to banish her all over again, this time to a different forest where she delivered babies and raised her two children single-handedly with help from a rishi who could see the future worth of a male progeny. So Agni Parikshas, as we can see, only had a limited shelf life. Sita never complained, said grandmother authoritatively. You must learn from Sita's patience and quietness. Young persons are not really equipped to ask questions that come very easily to an older intellect. If one questioned Sita's self-subsuming nature that bordered on a sort of immolation, for what else would we call a woman who jumped into a pyre and emerged unscathed? In Europe, she would have been declared a witch. If she did not die at the stake, then of course she would be put to death immediately thereafter in public view. In India, this did not happen to Sita. The first time she came back into the realm of the living, and tried to rebuild her life. The second time, there was no corporal body. Mother Earth swallowed up her unfortunate daughter. So the storytellers inform us. Sita was subsequently deified and she became a point of reference and was set up as an impossible role model. What are the life lessons that Sita as an icon offers to young women from all over India? What is the homegrown ingot of precious understanding that Sita bestows upon her innumerable sisters raised through the length and breadth of India? How is the Sita image created, cultivated, and yoked into the feminine unconscious through the length and breadth of a country? Innumerable women from different parts of India, how do they respond to her? In fact, until Nina Peli made Sita sing the blues, patriarchal wisdom barely imagined that Sita could possibly have anything to complain about, since after all, she was married to none other than Maryada Purushottam Ram. So you see, the second class citizen. And then of course, there was the manner of deportment which Sita carried out so well. She never argued, was seldom heard, and was punished with instant karma for accusing Lakshman, her faultless devar, of harboring evil designs when he expressed doubt about the authenticity of Maricha's cries for help that were meant to sound like Rama calling out in distress. So Sita, by speaking crossly and in a forward fashion to Lakshmana, in a sense was responsible for her own abduction by Ravana, much in the manner of modern young women who have erased Lakshman Rekhas by eating chow mein and speaking on cell phones, wearing clothes that are revealing and going out with men who are not their fathers, brothers, or husbands, and thereby inviting all manner of immediate punishment upon themselves. So when you look at this whole story of ideal deportment, how should women conduct themselves? You constantly don't look at what Sita's error cost her when she crossed the Lakshman Rekha. And this is reinforced from another text, the Mahabharata, where the highly educated, learned, trained, and skilled polyandrous Draupadi laughs in the hall at Indraprastha when Duryodhan mistakes a real pool for crystal and falls into the water. This must have been comic and must have triggered off Draupadi's visceral funny bone. Her laughter at the comic figure Duryodhana cut ricocheted off the walls of the women's quarters and was replicated and relayed in turn by the laughter of her ladies in waiting. This, an alert aunt would reiterate, triggered Duryodhana's rage. Such were the red alerts issued to us as young women. Do not provoke men and do not make them angry. Even the brilliance of a Draupadi failed when she angered the Skayan of the Kuru dynasty. If any one of us ventured feebly that there was never a working relationship between the Pandavas and the Kauravas, and this was all about the business of money management and resource management from the very beginning, and that Duryodhana could also not win her hand at the Swayamvar, stern looks from one or other wise fount of experience was enough to silence us, as we took on identities proffered to us from older tales without demurring. The prescribed qualities of the pantheon of women in our stories, who were usually from economically well-off houses, was that they had to be beautiful. And then all that was required was that a handsome prince, I mean, substitute prince with property at high income group employee, who would come by so that they could be betrothed to him, marry and live happily ever after. The caveat being that it was up to the woman to remain compliant, stoic, chaste, and unlaughing throughout this period. In case you think that this paradigm of femaleness is exclusively Indian, I'm going to read out to you two stanzas from W.B. Yeats, who won the Nobel Prize before Tagore, Nirmalya, although he introduced Tagore to the West. So Yeats's Prayer for My Daughter, written in 1919 when his daughter was born, that's 102 years from today, will demonstrate how the lines from this poem will demonstrate how the submissive daughter with no mind of her own and even less preferences is the virtuous object of desire across cultures. Yeats, for instance, actually says, I don't want a beautiful daughter because she will make a stranger's eye distraught. So Yeats is aware of the Ravan syndrome of the man who will come and abduct a beautiful woman. So he says, in courtesy, I'd have her chiefly learned. Hearts are not had as a gift, but hearts are earned by those that are not entirely beautiful. Yet many that have played the fool for beauty's very self has charm made wise. And many a poor man that has roved, men are allowed to rove, mind you, loved and thought himself beloved, from a glad kindness cannot take his eyes. May she become a flourishing hidden tree, that all her thoughts may like the linnet be, and have no business but dispensing round their magnanimities of sound. Nor but in merriment begin a chase, nor but in merriment a quarrel. Oh, may she live like some green laurel, rooted in one dear perpetual place. So this pattern of compulsory heterosexuality that also prescribes a code of conduct for women, first in the private sphere and later in the public sphere, as Yeats's poem also makes very clear, forms the mainstream cultural traditions in both the Hindi-speaking North and the Tamil-speaking South. It is possible perhaps to compile a collection of tongues and languages and shared commonalities that could be linked to these two linguistic groups. But for the purposes of this paper, I'm just going to, for this presentation, I would like to draw attention to two narratives that I grew up with. One is the story of Kannagi, an icon of Tamil literature, and the other is the story of Rani Padmini of Chittoragarh. And I'm choosing Padmini over Mirabai because, unlike Mirabai, who was allegedly a real person who wrote radical poetry, who sang radical bhajans and made a life transformative both for herself and for countless women, Kannagi and Padmini were fictionalized heroines from two works of literature, namely Silapadiharam by Illango Adige, who's a prince, and Padmavati by Malik Muhammad Jayasi. So the love story of Kovalan and Kannagi, enshrined in Silapadiharam, was written around the 4th century CE by Illango Adige. And this continues to be debated because people say, no, no, 1st century, then people say, no, no, 6th century. And this is an ongoing academic pursuit. Kannagi and Kovalan's story spans three Tamil kingdoms belonging to the Chola, Chera, and Pandya periods and presents them as contemporaneous. So Kovalan and Kannagi are the daughter and son of rich merchants in Puhar. And Kannagi is married off to Kovalan at a very young age. And both Kovalan and Kannagi join the ranks of prepubescent lovers, such as Romeo and Juliet, and remain immortalized in cultural memory as young lovers. Chennai today boasts of a very powerful Kannagi statue that dominates a beachfront. And Kannagi continues to be venerated as a symbol of female conjugal fidelity and chastity, otherwise known as Karpu, and remains to date Tamil Nadu's abiding female icon, who is revered as a chaste wife and as an epitome of Tamil womanhood. In Tamil Nadu and Kerala, she is worshipped as Bhagavati and Devi. And in parts of Sri Lanka, Kannagi is referred to as the goddess Patini by the Sinhala Buddhists and as Kannagi Amman by the Sinhala Hindus. And she's also seen as Bhadrakali, you know. So Kannagi is actually our local version of Bhadrakali, a virulent form of Shakti who is supposed to be awe-inspiring. So Kannagi's story is that she is married to Kovalan, who abandons her because he sees this really beautiful woman who sings very well and who's also a dancer and who is somebody who is known as the Kulvatu, and he fathers a child with her. So when I discuss Silapadiharam with female undergraduates, they can't understand her at all. So the questions I'm usually asked are, why doesn't she divorce Kovalan? They're very exasperated. He's such a loser. He's such a two-timer. And it usually takes a while before we can follow Kannagi and Kovalan through their misadventures and his death at Madurai. Meanwhile, Kannagi sets the city afire with her rage, kills a king and his wife and a lot of people in positions of power who abuse their authority, and ends her journey in Vanchi, where she's actually, taken away, and where she becomes a sort of goddess as well. Kannagi's loyalty to her husband who cheats on her and her commitment to him is part of the trajectory of a chaste wife that continues to be a significant value in modern India. conjugal fidelity and chastity remain the tropes that govern and fashion women's images, even in contemporary times. Evidence of this can be found within the rules inscribed in the domestic sphere that continue to be buttressed by powerful men and women in their public life and then slide into the collective unconscious through a reading of older texts that continue to be amalgamated in modern film and television series. Let me just draw your attention to one of Gandhi's essays about the extraordinary Hindu woman who possessed the ability to freeze assailants in their track with her virtuous indignation, thereby deflecting their lust and rapaciousness. And Gandhi's argument probably draws from figures of self-effacement whom we find in the Medho figures such as Kannagi or generations of numberless women who apparently voluntarily submitted themselves to the frames of Sati and Johar. So I'm just going to quote these lines from the Harijan, and these are Gandhi's words. Quote, "It is physically impossible to violate a woman against her will. The outrage takes place only when she gives way to fear or does not realize her moral strength. If she cannot meet the assailant's physical might, her purity will give her the strength to die before he succeeds in violating herself. For example, Sita." So this is the Harijan, 14 January 1940, when we are about seven and a half years from becoming a democratic nation. "When a woman is assaulted, her primary duty is self-protection. God has given her nails and teeth. She must use them with all her strength and if need by, die in the effort." And this is the Harijan, 1st March 1942, and we are inching 5 years away from independence at this point. And I'm sure that all of us as women who have spent valuable time manicuring our nails and painting them and looking at our hands, which are incidentally also televised as objects of great beauty and filmed as objects of great importance. I mean, who doesn't remember Kahona Pyar Hai and the nail polish and lipstick that becomes so important in that movie? Would have never thought that this is what women have been given nails and teeth for. So these two sentences that I just read out to, which were written by Mahatma Gandhi, draw attention to the overriding importance that is given to female chastity in Indian society. And his emphasis on female chastity and purity becomes very worrying, because his solution for the helpless woman under sexual assault is to die before the violation can take place. And this is a very traditional view of what women should do when they are sexually assaulted. So this is akin to harakiri or Johar, although there's possibly some kind of valor in harakiri, although the end result is the same. In the days of armed sexual assaults and gang rape perpetuated on women, the Gandhian solution is woefully inadequate. Yet it continues to be mouthed by women politicians. The late Sushma Swaraj, after whom a new university, a new college is being founded and named in Delhi, when she spoke about the brutality inflicted on Nirbhaya after she was gang raped, she refers to Nirbhaya as a zinda lash, for that is the status of a violated woman who has been stripped of her chastity, which continues to be seen as an exclusively female virtue. Because I'm no longer talking 1940 and 1942, I'm really giving you evidence from how women are looked at in 2013. It's important for us to recognize that chastity is as a virtue has been imposed upon women since times immemorial and has been the single most important cause of women's degraded status in society, one that has been recreated endlessly by the patriarchal powers that be. The idea of female virtue offered up by our epics in the instance of Sita and then through the Kannagi story continue to grip the imagination and occupy center stage when it comes to demarcating women's roles. So widows become an unacceptable surplus, because what role do these women have now that their husbands are dead? The divorcee who could not keep her husband is also viewed with suspicion, since her sexual proclivities remain suspect. And unlike the older widow, she cannot be tonsured and reclothed unattractively. arguably is therefore useful then to look at Sati and Jauhar as rites of passage that allow patriarchal authorities to monitor and control the surplus of women. And Sati herself, Shiva's first wife, is a mythical figure who immolates herself because her father insults her husband. For an ideal woman, even an insult is enough to lay down her life. Our most well-known recent Sati happened in 1987. And Sati temples today remain part of the topography of Rajasthan, especially Jhunjhunu. It is on occasions like this when the arguments refer to what happened amidst the gods that I begin to understand fully what Plato meant when he spoke of the malevolence in the heavens and among humans that could easily become normative. So I'd just like to go now and look briefly at the story of Padmavati, a poem written in 1540 over 57 cantos, comprising a large number of stanzas. And I must confess that I have only read an English translation of the whole poem, which is about 400 pages. And this is a translation made by A.G. Sheriff in 1944, published by the Royal Asiatic Society. Those of you who want to look at this, it's available on the World Wide Web. So Padmavati, that was written in 1540, has these two women characters. I mean, there is Nagamati, there are many women characters, but there are two queens. So there is Nagamati, who is the chief queen of Ratansen. And Ratansen then is told by a particular parrot about Padmavati of Sinhala, who lives in Sri Lanka. And Ratansen falls completely and totally in love with the description that the parrot gives him of Padmavati. So I mean, please understand how magnificent this is. Parrot doesn't have a film, doesn't have a photograph, cannot offer a video, but it just uses the power of description, the power of sound and language to tell, convince Ratansen of the beauty of Padmavati. So this is a long epic where Padmavati is being courted by a king who falls in love, a king who lives in the north of India and who seeks out this princess from modern day Sri Lanka. And she's referred to as a lotus girl of Sinhala. She returns to Chittoragarh. And while they're returning and crossing the seas, she is separated from Ratansen because of the storm. And because she can't see him, she is ready to become a Sati, newly married, few days old. For her, there is no meaning to her life if her husband is not there. So she says, I'm ready to die on the pyre. And this woman with this kind of training comes to Chittoragarh. And again, there is somebody called Alauddin, who's the Alauddin Shah, the text says, the emperor of Delhi, who has 1600 queens, whom he has brought from seven continents that he has apparently pillaged. And he gets to hear about Padmavati. How does he hear about Padmavati? There is a malevolent being called Raghav. And what Raghav does is to make some mistake. He's the court advisor and the poet. And because he doesn't perform very well, Ratansen decides that the best way to manage him is to sack him, which, by the way, is a terrible plan, because what Raghav does immediately is to rush off to describe to Alauddin the beauty of Padmini. And Padmini, this is something that I want us all to know about older literature. I mean, there is a lot of narrative that is celebrating female beauty. It's very sensuous. It's very very erotic, the poetry. And in fact, I find now that students who are politically empowered actually comment on this and say, you know, but this is not fair to the woman because they are protesting against what is the male gaze. But I also want to point out that this male gaze celebrates the female form. There is really no return. The female does not in turn offer a celebration of the male form as it were. But so what she really does is really celebrate whatever it is that the male is setting out to do. So anyway, after this protracted story in which in the story, Alauddin doesn't get to see Padmavati. She comes to him in a vision, but he started a battle and there's lots of cross-fighting going on because, believe it or not, those of you who only seen the movie Padmavat, Ratansen is killed by a fellow, a king called Devpal. And when he goes to attack him, because Devpal has actually tried to send somebody to Padmavati called Kumudini, and who has told her that why don't you go and you know, meat alauddin, because, you know, finally the pleasures of the body are very, very available for a very limited time. And, you know, you will lose desire, you will grow old, you'll become yellow. Padmavati is so angry when she hears this, because please remember, she's a chaste wife. She actually tonsures Kumudini and drives her out of the palace. But after all this happens, while Ratan Sen is attacks and kills Devpal, he has this spear which is lined with poison, with which he pierces Ratan Sen. So Ratan Sen also comes back and dies. And these two women, Nagamati and Padmavati, both of them perform sati. And incidentally, Nagamati and Padmavati actually have what would now be called a cat fight. Nagamati is apparently very dark and beautiful. So one must say of Jayashree's text that he did not, you know, talk about white as being better than black, which is a new point of comparison that we now have in modern times. And it is a king who comes and separates them and tells them that he loves them both very dearly and they are very important to him. So at the end, when both the queens perform sati, all their men are dead. And Emperor Alauddin the Shah now says, vanity of the world, throes of the earth. And the poet remarks that the desires of the world will remain until ashes fall upon them. So in this story, which ends with the larger frame of mortality, Padmavati and Nagamati and all their ladies in waiting in Sinhala and Chittoragarh, and the, you know, 1600 women in the emperor's harem from 7 continents, all of them are objects of great beauty desired and described. Padmini's beauty is first described by the parrot and then by Raghav Chetan, poet and pandit and advisor of Ratan Sen's court. And each, by the parrot and by Ratan Sen, each part of her body is described expansively and erotically. So Padmavati is presented as a very sensuous woman with an elephant gait, which, by the way, was popularized by M.F. Hussain, who made a film called Gajagamini. And this is something that was sanctioned to her by custom. So she is chosen by Ratan Sen. She's wooed by him. She pledges herself to this king, who courts her and actually becomes a yogi for her. So but these two women who are rivals go together as queen consorts to their Johar. So this is really the, these are the two older stories that I wanted to talk about, one located in 6th century CE and the other one in the 16th century CE. But I wanted to also show the connection between Padmavati and a serial that I saw on Disney Hotstar. It's a Tamil serial called Bharati Kannamma, which was released in 2019. And I'm just offering it up for discussion as an instance of a typical serial that provides an insight into the associations with the name of Bharati. Bharati is Tamil Nadu's famous poet and freedom fighter who spoke for the rights of Tamil women, spoke against child marriage, and he also was very much in love with his wife, who was called Chellamma. So he wrote a lot of poems describing Chellamma and her beauty and her attractiveness. And apparently after Bharati's death, these poems were published by his brother. But the name Chellamma was changed to Kannamma. And it's really interesting, because Bharati's brother felt that Kannamma was a more sophisticated name and that Chellamma was a very crude name. And both the names really mean beloved or dear one. So the writers of this serial, who pitched this as a story dealing with the trials of a woman's life, play with the title, teasingly evoking memories of poet Subramanyam Bharati and his wife Chellamma, in praise of whose beauty and virtues he wrote several poems. And there's actually a song, part of the theme of this film, in which Bharati, the character in the serial, is composing a song on Kannamma and he's calling her Chellamma. So this is really, so, you know, in tracing the love story of Bharati, Bharati falls in love with a dark-skinned, illiterate, but golden-hearted girl. And the narrative lists the tribulations that women go through in patriarchal societies that discriminate against them on the basis of their gender, ability, skin color. So dark-skinned Kannamma's mother dies when she's born, and she's raised by a stepmother who has a fair daughter. So fair stepsister plots with mother against dark stepsister on whose side is a hapless father, but he's unable to help his dark daughter against evil wife and daughter who terminate her schooling. Nevertheless, Bharati falls in love with this girl, inspired by her valor and ethical values, and marries her against his mother's wishes. And once she marries him, the woes of the world break around her shoulders because her mother-in-law is humiliating her for lack of education and dark skin. But Kannamma conquers all resistance and discovers that she is pregnant. And at this point, the mother-in-law is embracing her with open arms because there is a possibility of progeny. But suddenly into the narrative enters the villain, somebody more potent than first wife of Ratan Sen, who is a scheming female doctor, also the anti-heroine. And she poisons Bharati's mind and says that, look, you know, you are important. How does she know this? Because she's engineered an accident, at the end of which she fakes these tests to show Bharati that he cannot ever conceive, he cannot ever engender a child. So Bharati turns around, accuses Kannamma of not being faithful to him, of being unchaste. So she gets very angry and leaves the house. When she's pregnant, she doesn't go to a doctor, doesn't go to a gynecologist. So, you know, she's lying unconscious in a hospital. Her mother-in-law comes to visit her. Two babies are born. And there's plenty of drama because Bharati actually delivers one baby and leaves as social service, although he hates her and hates her unchaste behavior. And the mother takes one of the twins because she feels that this way she'll be able to unite the father with his child. And then it will be economically very viable for Kannamma to bring up one twin in poverty, one of the twins in poverty instead of two. So, I mean, so the chaste wife is played by Kannamma to the hilt, this particular role. She refuses maintenance, refuses childcare support, she refuses medical attention, and maybe the narrators are drawing attention to the flawed legal and medical systems in India that always fail us, fail everybody who's in desperate need of these services. But the story continues for 8 years with twists and turns, because having abandoned the possibility of legal settlement altogether, the scriptwriters move from 120-minute episode to another, stretching credulity, and introduce us to fashionably dressed women of various ages who have no occupation, no vocation or employable skills. Kannamma is a great cook and a seamstress. Her mother-in-law runs a cosmetic business by proxy because she spends all her time worrying about Kannamma and worrying about the kidnapped daughter whom she is raising. And Bemba is the evil female doctor, another study in misogyny, because despite being a doctor, she is jealous and unchaste. She lusts after Bharati, who's a married man. So she's really some sort of, you know, Surpanakha prototype. And she's ready to murder anyone who comes in her way. She also employs hitmen to kidnap and kill. So as per this story, there can be no women of intelligence in this new world. And women must be evaluated on the basis of their chastity, which is their raison d'etre for living. So one thing the rule book is clear about is, in all these modern narrations, there is for the modern Hindu male, the Ram model of monogamy, which incidentally is optional. The Krishna model exists and is acceptable, for our stories of gods and kings say so, do they not? For the woman, there is no choice. And as I pointed out to you, Kumudini in Padmavati, who comes to, ask Padmavati to go and meet the emperor and enjoy the pleasure of the flesh with him, is tortured and tonsured and humiliated and driven out of Chittoragarh. So this disappointing take on older narratives play into the Indian story of nationalism and women's freedom and rights in a modern state. And provide an instance of how popular narratives continue to shape and influence female identities, unable to create role models for modern Indian women in contemporary times. If Bharati Kannamma is a continuing saga of modern misdirected misogyny, what is even more worrying is the popular response that was elicited by the ancient story of Padmavati, the fabled queen of Chittoragarh, whose act of community immolation of Johar formed part of our history lessons about barbaric and savage India, where women had no rights over their bodies or lives at any point in their lives. How do we assess the response to the movie Padmavat that was released in 2017 in contemporary times? when this 16th century text Padmavati was made into the film Padmavat in the 21st century, it became a site of conflagration. And it ended in generating a past, instead of generating a past in which Hindus and Muslims coexisted within a complex matrix, the film split wide open the differences in religion and exacerbated gender roles and identities. Stones were thrown at unsuspecting school children traveling home in a school bus. Women from Rajput communities came out in large numbers in various districts saying that the screening of the film where a Hindu woman was being viewed lecherously by a stereotyped savage Muslim was an insult to Hindu womanhood. All the Rajput women protesting were only too willing to sacrifice their lives in order to avenge their honor. They were ready to commit Johar if the film was not banned. Meanwhile, a bounty of 5 lakhs was offered for beheading, no, for cutting off Deepika Padukone's nose. And state authorities and law and order administrators fell silent as they watched the uproar from the sidelines, along with hapless women and children who were definitely unwilling to pay the price of undertaking Johar in order to mitigate the damage done to their honor by Sanjay Leela Bhansali. The Karni Sena went on the rampage and spoke about the damage to Rajput well-being and the loss of Rajput dignity, while the CBFS, the Central Board of Film Certification, got Deepika's midriff digitally covered in order to respect the sentiment of viewers who ostensibly find it difficult to view parts of a woman's waist and stomach exposed on the screen. Our medium of learning or exchange where you can have a dialogue has changed from a literary text, and a long narrative poem has been replaced by the audiovisual genre of the film. What has not changed, however, is the limited roles envisaged for women over the centuries. The nature of policing has also changed. While erotic descriptions and celebration of the female form abound in the texts of Silapadiharam and Padmavati, the celluloid film industry responsible for itemizing and commodifying women is now being policed by the moral brigade that has very different, definite opinions about what women should wear, whom they should interact with, and whom they should speak to. What we are getting now is unidimensional portrayals of women in black and white who are either virtuous or wicked as per prescriptive norms. In fact, both Madhavi and Silapadiharam and Nagamani in Padmavati are fleshed out and well-delineated characters who are allowed enough space by the male imaginations that constructed them. Madhavi is a figure admired by the public in Puhar, while Nagamati is the first queen whom King Ratan Sen continues to love and respect. Oddly, as we move away from the trappings of religious formulations of women's roles and make sense of women's rights in a modern democracy, we find our hands full and furiously engaged in fending off the increasingly misogynistic practice that has become part of our populistic democratic everydayness in the decades of the 21st century. Simone de Beauvoir said in a previous century, one is not born a woman, one becomes a woman. Maybe to this poignant discovery of hers, we should add lines of our own. One is not born a woman, one becomes a woman informed by text, context, technology, and politics in a patriarchal world that continually raises its hackles when the subject of an inclusive world for women is raised. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Ratna, for a very passionate presentation of what I know is something very close to your heart. Both you've been teaching these texts and also you've worked extensively on these issues. So, and that's very evident. And also the comments that we have got is an excellent presentation. I don't see any questions coming from anybody. All everybody is saying is that these are excellent presentations. So Shruti, if you do get a question from our participants, there's nothing much to ask really, because it's been so comprehensive, the positioning, the intersecting lines that you've drawn between text, mythological text, and their presentation in contemporary visual, audiovisual, medium, there is no kind of doubt about what you're saying. But I'd like to remind you, I mean, not remind you in sense, just, thinking that between 1988 and 1991, state-sponsored Doordarshan telecast the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, which was a ritual Sunday morning exercise. And it did help in creating a pan-Indian consciousness about some of the things that you are talking about, the way those representations were being made. And I also think that, imagining characters, like you started by saying that it was your grandmother or your mother who told you stories and to ask questions, which were kind of answered by your, whoever was narrating those. But, I think in spite of the fact that those questions were answered, the questions remained. One could develop a consciousness later on where one could be independently looking at those issues. Whereas I think once these stories became an audiovisual, came to us through audiovisual mediums, the questioning became even less. Because the imagination was kind of impacted with a complete, what they wore, how they ate, how they addressed themselves, Matashri, Pitashri, Dadashri, all that, completely overwhelmed one's consciousness, and there was no questioning. Mm-hmm. And the visual medium tells you that this is real. You know, in some sense, it is a verisimilitude of what must have happened. I think that also has impacted us, and the kind of way where we probably stopped questioning in the same way as you or as we did it, or even our parents question. Whereas young people seem to think that what we saw on Doordarshan is must have been like that, those cardboard chariots and those thermocol, shields or whatever we are, pasted with silver and gold, So I think I can only add this onto what you just said, which was a very comprehensive and very brilliantly delivered points. Thank you so much, Ratna. Is there any question, Shruti?
No, sir, only words of appreciation.
Yes, I know. So I think, Shruti, should we bring this to an end?
Yes.
Wonderful session. That it was very nice seeing you, Ratna, after very long. And I, on behalf of my team here, on Shruti and Megha and Arzu and Shipra and Nidhi, everybody who's been doing this, we are very, very thankful to you for having accepted our invitation, and of course for we had no doubt about the brilliant quality of your delivery, that we were very sure of, but thank you very much for coming and being a part of the Ramanujan College program, and we hope that we'll be able to invite you even in the future for other programs that we will be doing. Thank you very much, Ratna.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you, everybody at Ramanujan College, for asking me to come and speak. And Megha knows how much trouble she had to go through to persuade me to be part of the recorded talk. And I have to tell you this. Maybe there's something in the universe, because I put in that program, which is called OSD or whatever, and the program just crashed on my computer. So I just decided to take this on. I just hope that we will be able to meet offline someday.
Yes, of course.
Because the problem with the teaching of literature and the talking of literature is that there has to be a dialogue.
Yes.
And I'm very happy that people enjoyed listening to me. I would be so happy if you know, they quarreled with me and said, why the hell are you saying this? So, I mean, which my students usually do, you know, when I'm teaching. So, I mean, I miss that interactive space, but thank you very much for having me. And
under the circumstances, this is the best we could.
I know, I'm aware.
Yeah.
I'm simply speaking of a pre-COVID.
Yeah.
COVID universe.
Or, you know, we are looking at a post-COVID situation where we'll surely call you. But, you know, Ratna, I must say that we have more than 400 participants for this program.
Okay.
And, about 200 plus of, you know, are there online.
I'm so sorry to interrupt. Can we just log out of the live session
and then maybe we can log out.
Yeah. No, that's completely fine, ma'am. I'm so sorry to interrupt. So just give me 1 second to get that done.
Yeah. Yeah. So Nirmalya?
Yeah. Bye, Ratna. We.
All right. So I see you.
Yeah.
When I see you, goodbye, Shruti, Megha.
Bye, ma'am. Bye. Bye, ma'am. Nirmalya sir, there's this YouTube written on your screen. Could you see that? Live YouTube.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
There is a drop box there, and there must be some option to stop the live streaming. Can you see that? Something
it
of that.
It says view stream. It says copy streaming link. Doesn't say.
Ma'am, it'll be different for us because we are co-hosts, but sir is the host of the meeting.
It says copy streaming and view streaming on YouTube. That's
awesome. It?
Yeah.
Lady, I think there
okay,
is.
Okay, so I'm really leaving. Sorry.
Yeah.
I think it's.
Yeah, Ratna, please.
I'm sorry, I interrupted your conversation, but everything
that's all
is.
Right, but,
Has it ended?
No. We are still on YouTube Live.
Mm. In fact, Megha, you are on screen now.